Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good to see you at church. And welcome back to the Jungs for the first time this year. We're going to start our service this morning with our first song, Now Thank We All Our God. Please stand. How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. I've stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I declare all the rules of your mouth. In the way of your testimonies I delight as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and fix my eyes on your ways. I will delight in your statutes and will not forget your word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your precious word. We thank you that you are not absent and that you chose to hand over to us words of wisdom, words of encouragement, commandments, and all the truths that people try to hide away. We seek your statutes and cherish them in our hearts. Help us today to listen to your message. Help us to do away with foolish things that our minds struggle to release. Instead, fill us with righteousness and guard us against foolishness. We ask today that our time together will be uplifting and it will draw us closer to our brother and our Saviour, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Our second song, I Know Not Why, God's Wondrous Grace. Please stand.
Thank you.
John, time for the announcements and the mission spot.
Morning. It's great to see everyone here this morning. I think I've got more on that side than this side. That's all right. We have to get more people to fill this side up as well. Just a few announcements. Craig's already mentioned we're certainly welcome back all the teams. They all got back safely to us. So that's really great. And so this week we've got Wollondilly Wednesday. Walking exercises to start with, and followed by the wellbeing program after that. Friday prayer meeting as usual, and TPK is on Friday at 3:15. Next Sunday there will be a communion, and also session will be meeting after the service, so I guess I'm asking if you can be praying for us during the week, that we make decisions that are really pleasing to God and also pleasing for our church here. The SRE commissioning service is mentioned for next Sunday, and that's going to be held at the His House Church. That's at 54 Bridge Street, Picton, and commence at 2 p.m. It's a commissioning service for Jake Berry, who's the recently appointed SRE teacher at Picton High. Really great service, I think. I guess everyone's invited to go to that, so right? Yeah, so if you're over at 2 p.m, as I mentioned, at his church, if you're able to go, it'd be really good if you can to, I guess, support the SRE, and especially for Jake Berry. Ladies' breakfast next Saturday, 8 a.m. And Enid is going to be the guest speaker for that one. So ladies, if you want to know more about that, talk to Jackie or Jan. And come along to it, it'll be really great. Robert's put in there and something that it is important, religious exemptions and Christian schools update. So make time to read that. It's an important thing that needs to be supported to let the Australian Law Reform Commission know how we feel about it. That's probably it.
Sorry, I left two things off the what's happening this week. Tuesday, there's Presbytery, which is also the induction of Andrew Satchwell, down at Kiama, which is very exciting. And also the SRE team are travelling down to, I'm going to say, Albion Park for training.
I don't know
if it's Albion Park. Albion Park always sounds
nicer. Yeah.
So, sorry, yes, those two other things happened this week.
So yes, things are getting busy once again as the year progresses. I don't think there's anything else mentioned there. That's probably it. So I might move on to the mission spot. It's for Oscar Elizabeth Euros. And I've had two emails, two videos from them. One on the 21st of January and one recently the 4th of February. So I'd like to start with one of the videos and read you a couple of emails I've got from them. So I'll just put the video on now. Thanks, Derek.
It's so amazing to be back in Blue Mountains again. We have just come from Brisbane. We're back here for a few days before we have to head back to Bolivia. We just wanted to say how much we've truly appreciated seeing everyone again. We catch up with so many old friends and actually make some new friends as well, and especially Catherine and Isabella, which has been fantastic for them and such an answer to prayer. We just wanted to say how much we appreciate all your encouragement and your prayers, And we know that we will have your support with us while we head back to Bolivia. We're so encouraged to keep on with our ministry there and really refreshed. So thank you so much.
So it's just a short video. So I'll just read a couple of things on this email. So the first one was received on the 21st of January. And it says, it's hard for us to believe that our home assignment is coming to an end. We've enjoyed the last few days catching up with friends in Sydney, Sydney region, before we fly back to Bolivia on Monday, 23rd of January. And seeing God's goodness and provision through so many faithful supporters and partnering churches during this time, especially the new friendships that Tabitha and Isabella have been blessed with. And they appreciate our prayers for them. And one I got on the 4th of February, After over 2 days of travel, we arrived safely back in our beautiful city of Tarija just over a week ago. We have been busy unpacking, organising a new home and getting Tabitha and Isabella ready for school. They've started classes a couple of days ago and are slowly starting to get back to their routine. And we thank you for your prayers. During this time, we also made a short interview with Tabitha. I had that video prepared for that. I did a interview Tabitha about how she felt, how things went, while they were away. Anyway, yeah, so they really appreciate us supporting them and praying for them. So I'd like to just finish by having prayer for the Euros. Heavenly Father, we do thank you and praise you for the Euros saved your trip back to Tarija. And we pray that Tabitha and Isabel, they will really settle in with school work and get back to the routine that's needed for them. We pray for the Euros, that they have guidance and wisdom and how to present God's word and God's ways with the people they are witnessing to. We do pray that you encourage them and guide the Euros in all that they do. In your Son's name, amen.
Thank you, John. I'll just pray for our offering. Please join with me. Lord God, we thank you that you know us inside and out, you know what we need, and that you look after us. Lord, we present back to you today our offerings to continue the ministry here and to grow the ministry here in Tarmor. Lord, we ask that you help those who make the decisions to make wise decisions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We come to our first Bible reading. Barry is going to be reading from Judges. Thanks, Barry.
Our reading this morning is taken from the book of Judges, chapter 21, and reading verse 25. In those days, there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. Amen. I love those short things. I love them.
A well read, Barry. Well read. Can I get you to stand for our third song, please? There is a Redeemer.
Messiah, Holy One. Jesus, my Redeemer, name above all names, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, oh, for sinners slain. And leaving your spirit till the work on earth is done. When I stand in glory, I will see his face, and there I'll serve my King forever in that holy place. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done. Precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Thank you, my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit to the work on earth is done.
Well, if the children would like to come down to the front, we've got lots of children here this morning. Joshua's got a message for you.
Okay, now Papia is getting big, so you can answer from there. Do you know when your brain works powerfully?
At school.
At school? Okay, when you study, when you're doing something, anybody knows when the brain works powerfully? Actually, I can tell you that. When I have a shower, my brain works really. And actually, I read a paper during the workshop that say, your brain works more efficiently, powerfully when you have break. Did you know that? It's exactly the opposite to what we think. So, how was your brain during the holiday?
Very great. My brain was sorting out the things.
Okay. All right. How was your holiday? Good. Yeah. Happy one.
It was all right.
So you recharge your brain. Your brain works really powerfully. And during the holiday, so this is what happened to me, that the brain just works really like brilliant. Alright? As soon as I walk into the my mother-in-law's house in Korea, everything was different. I knew that my father-in-law is not there. He passed away 3 or 4 months ago. Yeah, in September, August. So I knew that, but when I went in there, I feel that, wow, this is something that, yeah, it's unexpected. It's, I don't know, it's a mixture of emotion and all that. And one word came up to me when I was thinking of this one. And I can show you a picture. Can you see that?
Freedom!
Freedom. The freedom, that vocabulary. Do you know that you have a freedom this morning?
Yeah.
Then my question is that, how do you know that you don't have a freedom? How do you know that you have a freedom this morning? What's a freedom? Freedom is, yeah?
Whatever,
oh, that's dangerous.
Like, whatever you want, like,
power, things to what you want, okay? That you have, you can enjoy your power, things to do what you want, not whatever.
No,
okay. So, do you know that you have a freedom now? We don't know that we have a freedom now. But I can tell you that you know that you have a freedom when your freedom is taken away. That's the time that you know that you have a freedom, you miss the freedom. But when you have a freedom, you don't know that you have a freedom. Does that make sense? It's like oxygen. It's like oxygen. We are breathing. Now, we don't know that oxygen is around us. But when oxygen is taken away, we know that, wow, we miss that oxygen. And the freedom, when you are sick, your freedom is limited. And when the war happened like Ukraine, your freedom is limited. Okay? And the freedom is something that very important, a really great gift of God, but we limit the freedom by our sin. And when I was thinking about my father who passed away, we all will be in that situation. Then total freedom of us will be taken away. When we stand before God, there is no freedom at all. When we stand before God, there will be no freedom, but at the same time, one side there is no freedom, but the other side, you will have a perfect freedom. Okay? Because of what Jesus has done. And I'd like to remind you that. So that's freedom. Freedom, and I like to introduce to you this
Romans 6,
and I made eye contact with the papyrus so you can read it.
For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Okay, so why don't you make that as your memory verse for the year? And do you remember how you memorized this? I taught you, I think, a couple of years ago.
I don't know.
Okay, Romans. Row, boat, row, pointing, men, mm-hmm. Or any men. Okay, row, pointing, men, 6, 23, 4. You can follow me, you can do that. 4. How do you describe the wages? For the wages. For the wages of sin, okay, sin is death. How you do that? Yep. Okay, but the gift of God is eternal life. Okay, then in Christ our Lord Jesus. How do you do that? In Christ Jesus our Lord. Can you do this? Okay? You can repeat. Everybody can do that with me, alright? Row, point, man, 6, 23, 4, the wages of sin is death. Okay. But gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And this is my prayer with God. Ooh, chiki, 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 chiki. Yeah! Okay? One more, then you go back to the seat, okay? I'll pray for you. Right? Okay. Are you ready?
Yep.
Okay. Ready? Go. Romans 6. 23, 23, 4, the wages of sin is death. But gift of God is an eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So together. Ooh, chicky, 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 chicky. Yeah! I think I'm all excited. Okay, let me pray for you. Dear God, we thank you for the freedom that we have. We do not know that we have a freedom. Actually, we have a freedom. And a lot of times, actually, as a Christian said, we do the things, whatever we want, not thinking of you, Lord. Please help us to use the freedom according to your will. And we pray for our champions this morning that they know that they have a freedom. It is a free gift of God from you with eternal life. And when they stand before you, Lord, they know that they have a perfect freedom. Lord, pray that you protect them and guide them and continue to, Lord, nurture them. And please help us to teach them your word. And as they go to Sunday school today, they will have a fantastic time of learning and the fellowship and amazing time together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, well, as the kids go out to Sunday school, I'll just pray for us. Let's do that. Heavenly Father, we recognise and enjoy the fact that you are the King and that you are on your throne and that all things are in your control. We have nothing to fear as we are part of your family, your people that you rescued and called us to be with you. We read about Jesus speaking to his followers, how he sat down to be among them. We also look forward to sitting down in fellowship with you. Thank you for being a God who is caring and involved and a God who is good. We thank you, Lord, that amongst all the broken things of this world, that we are able to see the good things that have flowed from you. We thank you for the laws and the leaders in Australia who have shaped our nation through the Bible into one that is strong against things like corruption and lawlessness, and one that has systems to assist people who have fallen through the cracks. We thank you for the services and people who volunteer or are employed in roles that help others. We thank you for those people, Lord, and we do appreciate that they do so with minimal reward. We thank you, Lord, for a nation that has free education with no barriers for different people to access literacy and numeracy. And we pray, Lord, that all children will have access to Bibles, and we pray that they will read them. We thank you for scripture teachers, and we especially pray that children will be sent to those classes by their parents. We also pray, Lord, that religious institutions will continue to have the ability to select Christian staff to meet their ethos. Lord, we continue to pray for your church here in Wollondilly. We pray that we will grow in number and in unity of the Spirit. We ask, Lord, that you will protect our congregation from things like division, foolishness, and gossip, and that we continue to focus on you and our relationship with each other and the community. We thank you for Joshua, our minister, and his gifts, and we thank you that his family returned safe and rested. As we start a new week, Lord, help us to hang on to your truth and help us to flee from temptation. Make us forever mindful of Jesus and his loving sacrifice for us all. In his name we pray. Amen. We come to our second Bible reading from 2 Timothy, and Sue will bring that to us.
By the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you.
Thanks, Sue. And I'll call up Joshua now. I'm fascinated to hear a sermon from two Bible verses. Let's see how we go.
I think we need the wisdom, so let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for the two verses from the Bible, actually introduction to What is Our Legacy series that we will start this week. Please help us to understand what you bestow upon us and how we can actually pass on to the next generation. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a recap from the last year. That, do you remember what we looked at? Big two books last year? I know. I didn't meant to get answers from you, actually. Sometimes I forget what I ate last night, actually. Last year, we looked at two books, great books, Book of Judges. Do you remember that? We spent half of the year, 22 or 23 weeks. Things like that, and our second half was 2 Timothy, good stewards of faith and the speculative faith. And here is one sentence, a summary of a whole the series of Book of Judges, Judges 21-25. In those days, there was no king in Israel. What does it say? Everyone, except one single person. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. And we saw that unthinkable things happen in Israel, in the promised land, for the people of God. And if you remember the title of the series title was Let Brotherly Love Continue and Things Not to Do. That was the series. And that is the one verse summary of whole the series. And New Testament, Romans chapter 3, says the same thing. 3:23, for all. Everyone in this room and everybody in this world have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. In this world, then, my question is, and our question together that we're going to answer through next few weeks is, what is our legacy? What is our legacy? During the holiday, my brother Isaac rang me, and in the morning, about 11 o'clock, something like that, and he said, Joshua, I don't want to interrupt your holiday, but you should know this, and I need to pass on to you this news. And I think you need to be ready for this when you hear this. And I say, okay, I'm ready, tell me. Then he say that, you know your friend? Yeah? And he died this morning with a massive heart attack. And he's about my age. And we studied together at SMBC and Christ College, actually, together. And Anthony and his daughter went to the same preschool while I was studying. And we did have a training at the same church as a student minister for 4 years together. And I thought, wow, it was big, big shock. And his daughter found him dead. What is our life? I did have a few sleepless nights actually after that. Our life is vulnerable. And his daughter was planning to go to Korea in that morning and tried to get a lift from the dad and found him dead. So whole plan and everything was upside down. How long do I have here on earth? Am I gonna be here forever? The answer is no. Then why we live here like eternal life? Do you know the answer? When we are gone, what is our legacy? What is our legacy? After I came back from Korea, I did have a spring cleaner. So metaphorically speaking, spring cleaner means not the house cleaner, my computer cleaner. Once a year I do that in January after the holiday. my computer just all like files and here and there and say, so I just delete some files and keep them in the, rearrange all the files in the furniture in my computer. And I found this one. And I found this one a year ago, a couple of years ago, when we are in isolation, like we can't go anywhere. And I thought, okay, it's a good time to actually draw our philosophy together. I teach my children, and we did that together in a connectors group. So I try to explain to my children, say, okay, this is not what we want to do. This is not what we want to be, all right? Philosophy is actually what you are already doing in. And I will help you to articulate that. And what we are already doing it and try to make it clear. And how we live, actually. So here it is. The questions that I asked. And each question that I explained at the background of it. Who should I be? We are not animal, right? We are not dogs or monkey, or we are human. We are made in the image of God. Who should I be? And how can I become the person who habitually does the right, even in adversity? You're not blaming other people, you're not blaming anybody, but how can you become a person who habitually does the right? And how can I obtain the character to do what is right? And to what causes or goals should I devote my energy? Devote means you give up important things for the most important things. And what should we pursue? Okay, how can we distinguish from the error? Because the things that error is not any more error in this world. And how can we gain discernment? I love this vocabulary, discernment. It's wisdom and more than wisdom. And what is our duty as a Christian? Okay, not legalistic Christian, but we do have a duty. And what should I do? What should I do? So from that, explain, I did have a 1 week, and we tried to articulate that. And that next slide, if you see that, that's our like summary of our philosophy, not mine, our children. And the boundary is that honest, as a Christian, honest is important, and you got to be confident that you are in Christ, then you are inspiring Christian and forward-looking. Basically means that what you do now is the future. That's all about English grammar. What you do now is the future. So if you looking at next slide, and one, the first philosophy that my children have is evangelism. Evangelism, then I didn't think about seriously, but when I opened this one, when I read it, I thought, wow. The children, okay, can understand this one. Why we need evangelism? Why we need to share Jesus Christ, our Lord? Because nobody is perfect. Which means everybody is sinful. Everyone is a fall short of the glory of God. But we are redeemed by Jesus. So we should share the gospel with the people. When they show me, when they write this one a couple of years ago, I didn't think about this one seriously, but when I read it again, it's a deep, very theological. Not hiding our belief when it's inconvenient. Example, party. When you go to party. So act as if Jesus is there with you, physically. We are all different in this room. We have all different background and different family background, and we are living in different houses and all that, but we have a commonality. One thing that we all have is a sin. Then God gave us a freedom. Our freedom will be taken away, will be taken away one day. And you will receive the perfect freedom in Christ, or that freedom will completely remove from you. Depends on your belief. If you remember, 8th of June 2016, That's Oscar's birthday, actually. 8th of June 2016 is Oscar's birthday. This is coincident. 8th of June 2017, the terrible thing happened to me 6 years ago. When it happened to me, and you know that, not knowing that, I'll be still around in Tamil. I didn't know that, to be honest with you. And to be honest with you, I didn't know that. I am with my church family. Today, I'm preaching. And so, at the time, I prepared the message in the Cedar Lane Missionary Homes in New Jersey. I prepared the message. And you heard that? And if you remember, that's great. If you don't, that's fine. And it was about you, our church family. You already have this one. You already have this quality. And let it continue. Do you remember that? Do you remember what it was? I'll try to avoid eye contact. That's all right. The message was 2 Thessalonians 4:9. It says, "Now concerning brotherly love, you have no need for anyone to write to you. For you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. For that indeed is what you are already, what you are doing to all brothers through Macedonia," but in Tamil, okay, for us. "But we urge you, brothers, to do this more and more, and to aspire to live quietly, and to mind your own affairs, and to work with your hands. And we instructed you, so that you may walk properly before outsiders and dependent on no one." I preached that. And Hebrews chapter 13, verse 1, "Let brotherly love continue." And at the time I thought that my job is to articulate what we already have at Wollondilly Presbyterian Church. But if I say like the things that we don't have and I say you should have that, that doesn't work. It would be different. When the biggest crisis hit me, when I wept over my bitter pains with Cindy and my elders and my church family, when the biggest crisis hit me, my life is upside down. And you know what? That time was brilliant time. My mind, my brain power works brilliantly, wonderfully, most powerfully. I just can't believe it. I don't have that brain power anymore because my life is comfortable. But when my life is so terrible, my brain works just amazing power. And what am I here for? What am I here for? Do you have an answer for that? What am I here for? When Paul was writing the book of 2 Timothy, Paul was heading to his death, actually. He knows that his trial is not going to go well this time. He will die soon. And he will be executed, chopped the head off. And he was a Roman citizen, so not the cross, but execution. And Paul is facing his final hours. What is in his mind? What does he want to say to leave the legacy? So that's the series that we're looking at. What is our legacy? Introduction. 2 Timothy 1:14 says, "By the Holy Spirit who dwell within us, God the good deposit entrusted to you." That is what Paul invested in Timothy. That is his legacy for Timothy to carry on in his heart and in his mind. And that is what we do to each other through brotherly love in this place. The trust, the truth that leads us to salvation. When you look at the Bible, there are primary truths and the secondary truths, if you're looking at the Bible. There are primary truths and the secondary truths. The primary truth is about our salvation only through the gospel that we are saved. That's the primary truth. And the secondary truth is like church governance. So many different denominations, like Presbyterians and Anglicans and the Baptists and Congregationals and Methodists. You can agree and disagree the form of the governance. But the truth that leads us to God is unchangeable. Doesn't matter whatever the denomination is in, if you believe in the Bible, that is unchangeable. Paul is saying to Timothy, guard that what is entrusted to you. This is not politics, because guarding the gospel is an eternal business. Lots of politicians can't see themselves beyond their election day. Very short-sighted. Paul is looking beyond his lifetime. So are you looking beyond your lifetime? Are you looking beyond your lifetime? He knows that he's not going to be around much longer now. So what does he concern about? Is he concerned about being his head chopped off? I can't imagine how difficult it will be that if I'm in that situation. But Paul concerns about the future generation will not lose the gospel. That's crazy, brilliant, powerful. Paul concerns about the future generation will not lose the gospel, the primary source of the Bible about our salvation. What is our legacy? 2 Timothy 1:14 again, by the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you. That's the introduction. And just wondering about how we're going to go about our preaching series, and I'd like to introduce to you. I have a 4 series lined up. One is a justice series. Do you remember that? I read a book, Just Justice. That's one semester course of the Harvard University, the course Justice. And I learned something from there, in the secular, what they think about us. But when we're looking at the Bible, what is our justice? You have a question for that. So Justice series is lined up after 2 Timothy. We're going to looking at that one. And second, the series is very interesting. I attended many preaching conferences, even like in a preaching course and how to preach and evangelism course and all that. But I never heard of like how to listen to sermon. Have you heard of that? How to listen to sermon. So that's going to be the series, how to listen to sermon. And the next series is divine plan and human responsibility. And that's that. The background is you saw that you raised, like heading back to Bolivia, and we had a good relationship with them. Personally, I do have a personal good relationship with Oscar and Elizabeth and the kids. And this time when they come over and they're doing the children's business, children's ministry in Bolivia, in Argentina. Then when they come up to our place for lunch, and Oscar and Elizabeth mentioned about, we're doing this ministry for the children, but we are so short of the training, the pastors. And he actually asked me that, can you come over one day, do some kind of training for the pastors, preaching or whatever the topic that you have. And as I think of that, one of the topics that I really, really looking and interested in is a divine plan and human responsibility. And that is about our free will and freedom. And I have discussed good discussion with Craig as well. That's a big topic. And that's what I'm preparing. If I go there, that's a series that I'm preparing. And so I thought, okay, it's good for our church family. Our free will, how we use it. We have a divine plan and human responsibility. That's the series of it. And efficiency. That's in my mind for a while. So that's what we're looking at it. So this is a good lined up for the year that I am preparing for the series. And that will cover like a whole year, maybe half of next year. And I have another series lined up. But anyway, I'd like to show you the YouTube clip about 2 Timothy, and you will have a big picture of what we'll be looking at for next few weeks. So here we go.
Paul's second letter to Timothy. This is Paul's final and most personal letter. He wrote it from yet another time in prison, and it's addressed to Paul's dear co-worker and protege, the young Timothy. Now, we don't know how much time exactly has passed since he wrote 1 Timothy, but we can see that Paul's situation has changed, and for the worse. He's imprisoned in Rome, which could refer to his time under house arrest that was mentioned in Acts chapter 28, or it could be that he was released from that imprisonment, had another long season of ministry, and then was arrested again in Troas. Either way, Paul says he's in the middle of his court trial now, and it is not going well. He's pretty sure he's not going to survive this one. And so out of this very dark situation, Paul appeals to Timothy, who it seems is still on assignment in Ephesus. He asks Timothy to come be with him in prison so Paul can pass on to him the church planting mission he started. The letter's design is pretty simple. There are two large sections where Paul challenges Timothy, first to accept his calling as a leader, and then, before he comes to Paul, to deal with the corrupt teachers that are still causing problems in Ephesus. After this, Paul concludes the letter. So Paul begins by thanking God for Timothy and his family, specifically for his grandmother Lois and his mother Eunice. They immersed the young Timothy in the story of the Old Testament scriptures. They instilled in him a deep faith in the Messiah Jesus. And so because of that firm faith, Paul offers his first challenge to Timothy. He calls him to reject any temptation to be ashamed of the good news about Jesus or of Paul, who's suffering in prison for announcing that good news. Now, the reason Paul needs to emphasize this is the negative stigma that he gained by his frequent times in prison. It made many of Paul's co-workers, in fact, doubt his calling as an apostle. He mentioned two guys, Phygellus and Hermogenes. They deserted Paul because they were ashamed of being associated with Paul, who was an accused criminal now. So Paul asked Timothy to reject any fear of shame and to come see him. Now, Paul knows that this is a costly request. It could put Timothy at risk. And so he reminds Timothy that Jesus' grace is a source of power, which is really important. You're going to need it, because following Jesus is not easy. It requires everything that you have. Paul likens following Jesus to enrolling as a soldier who's striving to please their commanding officer. Or it's like an athlete who's training their body for competition. Or it's like a hard-working, dedicated farmer. All three of these metaphors involve a person who's committed to something bigger than themselves and who's willing to sacrifice and endure challenges to accomplish a greater goal. And of course, the highest example of this is Jesus himself. Because of his commitment to the Father, he suffered crucifixion by the Romans. And similarly, Paul himself is now suffering in a Roman prison. Hardship and sacrifice are inherent to the Christian life. And this is why Jesus' resurrection is the foundation of Christian hope. Or as Paul puts it in a short and very powerful poem, if we died with him, then we will live with him. If we endure, then we will reign with him. If we deny him, then he will deny us. If we are unfaithful, he will remain faithful, for he is unable to deny his own nature. God's love for our world has opened up a new hope through the death and resurrection of Jesus. And so for those who will take the risk of trusting and following Jesus, God promises vindication and life. For those who reject him, God will honor that decision and do the same. But people's faithlessness will never compel God to abandon his faithfulness. And so Paul calls Timothy to faithfulness, knowing that it may come with a cost. Paul moves into the second half of the letter, calling Timothy to confront the corrupt teachers in Ephesus before he comes to Rome. Their teaching is spreading in the Ephesian church like a cancer. They've targeted and corrupted a number of influential women in the church. These are likely the wealthy women that Paul had to deal with in his first letter to Timothy. He doesn't offer much detail about the teacher's bad theology. Timothy already knows about it, but he does give us one hint. He says they teach that the resurrection has already taken place. Now, we don't know if the teachers are following a Greek philosophical rejection of the whole idea of bodily resurrection, and they think it's only really about spiritual experience, Or it could be that they've simply distorted Paul's teaching about the resurrection life that begins now through the power of the Spirit. Either way, the problem is that they've abandoned the robust future hope of resurrection and of new creation, and they've embraced instead a private, hyper-spiritualized Christianity that is disconnected from day-to-day life. And so Paul calls Timothy to raise up faithful leaders who are going to teach the real good news about Jesus. They should avoid senseless arguments that result from debating the teachers. In contrast, Timothy and his leadership team are to keep the main thing the main thing. They should focus on the core storyline and message of the scriptures, which in Paul's day meant primarily the Old Testament. These scriptures, Paul says, are able to give you wisdom that leads to salvation through faith in the Messiah, Jesus. He's saying the whole point of the scriptures is to tell you a unified story that leads to Jesus and that has wisdom to offer the whole world. Then Paul talks about scripture's nature and purpose. He says all scripture is divinely breathed, literally God-spirited. It's a reference to the Spirit's role in guiding the biblical authors so that what they wrote is what God wanted his people to hear. And God speaks to his people in the scriptures for a very practical purpose. He says they're useful for teaching, telling me things I didn't know before. They're useful for challenging, getting in my face about the things I say I believe but I don't actually live consistently with. They're useful for correcting me, exposing my messed up ways of thinking and behaving. And they're useful for training me in righteousness, showing me a new way to be truly human. And this is all so that God's people will be prepared for doing good. Paul closes the letter by reminding Timothy that he's probably not going to make it out of prison alive. So he asks Timothy to come as soon as possible, before winter. He doesn't want to freeze in his cell, and so he's going to need his heavy coat that he had to leave behind. And also, could Timothy please bring those personal documents that he left in Troas, likely when he got arrested. He also mentions Alexander, who's an especially dangerous man that Timothy should avoid. He's probably responsible for Paul's most recent arrest. Paul concludes by mentioning how nearly everyone's abandoned him in prison, and his only source of comfort now is the personal presence of Jesus, who stands with him and will deliver him even if he dies. And so the letter ends. The letter of 2 Timothy stands as a reminder that Paul's very influential life and mission were marked by persistent challenge and suffering and struggle. Following Jesus involves risk and sacrifice. It means inviting tension and discomfort into your life. And these things are not a sign of Jesus' absence. Rather, as Paul discovered, with generations of Christians after him, that precisely in those dark and difficult moments, Jesus' love and faithfulness can become the most tangible and real. And that's what 2 Timothy, Paul's final letter, is all about.
I hope you're excited about looking at 2 Timothy together next few months. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for this amazing book. We can't imagine that in a prison cell 2,000 years ago, the winter is coming, and only comfort is Jesus, his presence in the prison cell. Lord, please help us to understand that what Paul think of, Lord, because we're living in abundance. We have everything. We have a comfort life. But Lord, please let the 2 Timothy, the book, challenge us as we're living in this very comfortable country and how we live as a Christian life and how we live together in this world as we leave the legacy for the future generations. We're not just here for now, but Lord, we are here to leave the legacy for the generations to come. Please, Lord, help us to be diligent on that. And please, Lord, guide us and lead us and feed us through the Bible and protect us, that we'll be able to carry the duty and the responsibility with the joy, with the peace and the hope through our Jesus Christ, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thanks, Joshua. All right, we'll sing our next song from YouTube. Let Your Kingdom Come. Please sing.
Dying breath.
a good chorus to have ringing in your head as we leave for a new week. Let me read a verse from Romans, Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. Amen. We have the band back to sing our benediction. Now on to him. Great week, everybody. Grab a cup of tea on the way out.